podcast. Just search for The Pulse of St. Louis.
Welcome back to The Pulse. You know, some people have lost weight during the pandemic, as we just heard from Dr. Braithwaite, and she was telling us all about her journey, and others have packed on COVID-19 pounds. And if your New Year's resolution is to lose weight, we have some tips to help you accomplish your goals. Joining us now is Charles D'Angelo. He is the nationally acclaimed transformation coach, and he is the one who helped Dr. Braithwaite lose her weight. So thank you so much for being here, Charles. You know I'm excited about this conversation.
I'm very excited to be here with you, Shirley. It's good to see you.
Yeah, so you know what it's like to gain weight and then struggle to lose it. So before we talk about Dr. Braithwaite and others whom you've helped, tell me about your weight loss struggles.
Well, I've been there. I was 360 pounds as an adolescent, so I know exactly what it feels like to be stuck, to feel isolated, to feel as if there's really no hope for the type of change that you saw in my client, Dr. Braithwaite's brilliant example of what taking personal responsibility can bring about in life. I mean, I was the kid who ate lunch in a bathroom stall in grade school. I was the kid who didn't have a date throughout high school. So I recognized at that very young age that despite all the different attempts I had made, the pills, the drinks, the gyms, the trainers, that there was something missing in everything else out there. And I've spent my life helping people deal with that missing component. What's the missing component? How to change your mindset, how to change your relationship with yourself so that weight no longer is really, let's say, a symptom of the problem. And that's really, for most of my clients, the true issue. It's obvious with a client like Dr. Braithwaite, who's incredibly educated on the science of healthy eating, on exercise, and their impact on one's health, what she needed to do, right? I mean, most of us know what we need to do. The trouble is why we don't act on our knowledge. So coming from a history of being morbidly overweight and obese, and coming from a family that certainly didn't have much education in terms of the impact of those choices, I can relate with the people who come to my office that feel completely lost, hopeless, and desperate. And it's what fuels me every day and gets me so excited when I get to meet someone who might just be about ready to give up on themselves and know that with a new strategy, a new mindset, anything's possible.
And when you say a new mindset, are we talking about a new mindset as it relates to food and our dietary habits? Are we talking about exercising? Are we talking about making a conscious decision? What are we talking about when you say change your mindset?
So I think that you have to stop looking at weight as the problem. It certainly can pose a problem. But the way I look at the work I do with people, first off, I see it as my mission, kind of a vocation. I don't see it as a job. I see weight as a symptom. So when I was 360 pounds as a teenager, it wasn't that I thought a Snickers bar was healthier than an apple. I had to recognize that if I wanted my life to get better, I was going to have to get better. There is no magic bullet to transformation. It's a result of consistency. And to your question, it certainly involves changing the relationship that you have and the meaning that you give to food so that you don't have this reflexive strategy, shall we say, or almost unconscious habit of reaching for something when an emotion comes up in you that you're not comfortable with. So it's all about recognizing that we're all engaging in patterns. And the patterns we're engaging in can either help us or hinder us. So you have to change the way that you relate to food. You certainly have to use it strategically. You can't be spontaneous. You've got to decide upon a path that seems reasonable, intelligent, and sustainable. So the way I encourage my clients to go about it on the program, and the program is pretty much the same for everybody, is eat 6 times a day, all healthy foods. So things that aren't going to spike your blood sugar and then cause you to crash. It also means make exercise a regular ritual every single day. So even a person like Dr. Braithwaite, who's lost over 100 pounds this year working with me and has an incredibly busy schedule helping so many people who are struggling with the pandemic, even she made the decision that she was going to put her needs first if she was going to take care of others. You have to recognize that old analogy of if you're in an airplane and it starts to descend unexpectedly and the oxygen masks come down, what do they tell you to do? Do they tell you to take the mask and put it on your child first? No. They say you've got to put it on yourself first if you're going to be able to take care of other people. So that relationship also has to change. That philosophy that you have has to shift. So she wakes up every single morning, and the first thing she does is hops on that treadmill and gets that in. Thirdly, you've got to change the relationship you have with yourself. You've got to start seeing yourself as worth having the quality of life that one can achieve.
So the program that you're talking about and that you advocate, Charles, does it fit everyone, all of your clients, or do you have to adjust it for each individual client?
So I think of it this way. I think of it as a philosophy. So what I teach my clients is a philosophy of life. The eating program is available. If people are wondering, what do Charles's clients eat? My work isn't about a diet. I'm not a dietitian. I'm not a nutritionist. It's about disconnecting from using food emotionally. And I certainly think that anyone who finds that they know what they ought to be doing, they feel like they've tried everything, should give themselves the opportunity to explore the way I look at things, which is, it's not about the food. It's not about what you're eating as much as what's eating you. You've got to look at, why am I using food this way, almost like a drug? And so the work I do here in my office is all about helping people understand the belief systems that have brought them to a place they never intended to be, almost unconsciously. And then look at what that belief system is and ask, what can we replace it with that's going to actually move them towards where they want to be? So I look at weight loss in the work that I do as a dividend, surely. So I know, I mean, I've been on your show for what, over 10 years or something like this. I'm starting to date myself. I know that I'm known as, you know, the physical transformation specialist, whatever. But the work with me is all about the inner work. It's all about starting to look at whether or not you're really practicing self-love every day by attending to yourself, being appreciative of yourself, showing your body the affection it deserves by exercising, eating well, resting, right? Giving yourself the relationships with others where you can express your emotions openly and really deal with things in a healthful way rather than use substances like food ineffectively, and then ultimately make space in your life to move towards the things you really want rather than being so reactive.
And so tell me, what exactly is your role as a transformation coach then, Charles? Because you said yourself, you're not a trainer, you're not a dietitian. How do you help your clients accomplish their goals?
I laugh because, you know, I've been at this. I lost all my weight when I was 16, 17 years old, between 16 and 18. And I was probably one of the first people here in the Midwest that called himself a coach. And so that's the way I see myself. I see myself as not better than my clients, but as a peer, someone who has an objective perspective and has a set of tools that I offer to my client so that they can decide whether or not they want to embrace them and start to use them and experience the dividends of the use of those tools. So I look at it as kind of like, if transformation is a journey. I am the passenger in the car with a map, that being the skills, the tools, the strategies, and my client is in the driver's seat. How quickly we get to where they intend to be, their aim, how many detours, how many pit stops we take is going to be a function of the client. So I look at it as helping a person in a, I would even hesitate to use the word helping. I would say accompanying a client in exploring their life, really looking at what they're up to and having a really objective look at if they're getting the sense of fulfillment from their life that they intend. So many people that come to see me are incredible achievers. I've had the privilege of working with world leaders. I've had the privilege of working with people like Dr. Braithwaite, who is a prominent medical physician. And I can say that despite all the achievements so many of my clients have been able to reach, many still feel like something's missing. So I help people uncover what is that and how do we get to the place where we wake up with a certain excitement for our day again, where we have anticipation for our lives. With this pandemic, mental health and depression, sadness, anxiety, all these things are things people now are confronting on a daily basis. So just sometimes having a conversation with someone else objectively that can remind us of our own personal power can really, really, really be helpful. And I think that that's the role that I seem to fill in many of my clients' lives, being a fellow explorer in their life journey.
And so how do we stay focused, especially now, because you touched on how stressful it is now and how a lot of us are filled with anxiety and a lot of us are just eating because we are bored or because we are going through a depressive state or we're filled with anxiety. How do we stay focused when so much is going on?
Well, first off, I think that it's really important to have a clear set of goals. You know, the way I look at it is you can't be excited about somewhere you don't know you're headed. So you've got to define for yourself, where do I want to be? Who do I want to meet? How do I want to feel? What do I want my relationships to be like? So many of my clients' issues simply have to do with they don't have any blueprint for the direction of their life. They simply feel almost at reaction to life. And all of us, given this last 12 months, to some degree, can totally relate to that. I mean, things are changing so rapidly, it's difficult for any of us to really feel as centered, perhaps, as we would prefer to. So first, you've got to have a clear set of goals. And if you're working with a coach, you can sit down with that person and start to define for yourself, what do you want to achieve in the different domains of your life that matter? Physically, relationally, emotionally, professionally, spiritually, right? What are your practices in all those areas? Where would you say you fall in those areas? And where is there room for improvement? Having those goals alone will do a lot to inspire you because goals are like magnets. They pull us through the challenges of life. But without goals, we're just kind of adrift.
So I think you're absolutely really right. Good point, Charles. I got to let you go. I'm out of time. But I want to thank you so much for being here and thank you so much for what you're doing in the community to help so many people.
Shirley, it's my absolute privilege and pleasure. And anyone watching, just know it will get better. You can do this. There's no doubt in my mind. You've just got to be willing to do the work.
All right. Thank you so much, sir.